Greetings, programs. This is Rhett, and welcome back to Judge Dredd, Countdown Sector 106. In the last episode, Dredd responded to a call of a disaster at a shopping center, which apparently was nothing more than a distraction for a group of thugs to try and rob the place. Well, we dispatched the thugs as well as a very large dinosaur, and Dredd is back on patrol, so let's see what trouble he gets into this time. You park your Lawmaster up and stroll into the plaza. Everywhere you go, citizens are desperately trying not to attract your attention, avoiding your glare as you pass. You pick a likely spot near to a holding post and point your daystick at a passing citizen. You, citizen, come here. Strip search. A mouth, who, me? Only delays the inevitable for a few seconds. You give the citizen a curt nod. The slumped-shouldered citizen trudges forward as you push him against the wall and begin the search, all the while asking questions. Eventually, you handcuff him to the post for illegal possession of coffee. Wow. You then turn out to pick your next target, choosing a slightly overweight man in a yellow crimpling suit. You make several more arrests. As citizens become aware of your presence, the deserted area surrounding the holding post begins to widen. With a temporary lull in crime, you are not needed elsewhere, and you look for the next citizen to search. You are scanning the streets when you notice a figure duck into an alleyway across the plaza out of the corner of your eye. Your suspicions, honed by decades of experience on the streets, are roused. So we can yell at the figure to stop, we can try to follow from a distance, or ignore the figure and continue picking out citizens at random. Let's go ahead and try and follow this person from a distance. You cautiously follow the figure as she heads off down the alleyway. When you reach the corner, you see her in an insurance office through a door to the right. Do you sneak up to the office and try and see what's going on inside? Do you burst through the office's entrance hoping to take anyone within by surprise, or do you prefer to enter the low-rent stacker opposite the office so you can observe in secret any activity? Well, a stakeout would be good, but I'm not exactly sure what this whole incident is, so let's go ahead and sneak up to the office to try and see what's going on. You move to the office window and try to peek through the window. There's a small gap where the blinds have not been fully closed. You see the woman you were following talking to three men in suits. They're all looking at a small box she appears to have put on the table. One of the men unlocks a drawer and hands over a bundle of cash. You catch a glimpse of a gun in a holster under his jacket. It looks as though you have stumbled upon something serious. At that moment, you sense something else is in the alley. You quickly turn to face them and see another man in a suit, holding a gun. He shoots wide, but you place a well-armed round from your lawgiver into his forehead. He goes down instantly, but any element of surprise you may have had now is lost. Did you attend the briefing room back in the Sector House earlier today? Yes, I did. You recognize this creep to be one of Gunzotti's mobsters. As you have inside information on how these mobsters operate, your lawgiver skill increases by one for this encounter. What will you do now? Do you burst through the window hoping to regain the element of surprise by using this maneuver? Or use the door instead, relying on your superior skills to overcome those inside? Well, if they heard us outside, they're probably all focused on the door, so let's go ahead and try and burst through the window. You crash through the window to gasp of surprise from the perps. Make a fitness check. Uh-oh. Okay, we need to roll low on a fitness check. Low roll? Nice.
No problem.
Indeed. You land and roll, glass showering the room. A deep voice yells, "You idiot, Candace! You brought the law!" There are four people inside this office, the young woman you followed inside and the three men in suits. Everything happens in the blink of an eye. The men all pull guns, and one fires several rounds into the woman's body. She looks at her killers, then to you, but she is dead before even hitting the floor. As you come out of the roll, you swing round your lawgiver. So, easy check. Nice.
Bad move, creeps.
You're too fast for these men, and you manage to get off a round in the blink of an eye. Your ammo hits one of the salesmen directly in the neck. With a grim smile, you begin firing at the two remaining perps, who are shocked by your unerring accuracy. Do you wish to try and take out both of these men, or will you make it easier for yourself and go for one opponent at a time, but take the risk of being shot by his partner? Let's go ahead and try and take out both of them. To take down both of these men, you need to make a shootout roll of medium. I'm probably not going to roll as high as I did, unfortunately. Oh! We got it! The remaining two hoods are no match for your training and many years of experience on the streets. Soon their guns fall silent and you approach a package on one of the desks. You look closely and it's obvious that it is an explosive device of some sort. Suddenly you hear a click from behind you and instinctively you dive to one side, just in the nick of time to avoid as a gun blasts to your back. yet another perp to be brought to justice. Alright, another, maybe a low roll to make up for that high roll. Nice.
No problem.
Whew. Good stuff. At the last moment, you manage to shift sideways and the bullet lodges harmlessly into a cabinet behind you. Time to take down this last hood. Shootout of difficulty of easy. Did that do it? Yes, it did.
Bad move, creeps.
Ooh, getting our gunslinger on. The last perp falls to a well-aimed shot, and you wait a short while before checking outside for any further surprises. When none are forthcoming, you finish your search of the office. You run checks with control and find three of these men are connected to a local protection racket. Obviously, the insurance company was a front. The woman is identified as Candace Boomer, a bomb maker and incendiary device is on one of the desks. It is evident you have prevented a major criminal incident by investigating these perps. With this case now closed, you're free to continue your patrol. Nice. It is still very quiet on the crime front when you get back to the plaza. With nothing urgent requiring your attention, there are two ways to keep yourself occupied while still cracking down on crime. To Crime Blitz Apartments within Tom Clancy Block, turn to 1029. If you would rather ask the Public Surveillance Unit to identify known perps in the plaza and follow their movements, perhaps discovering illicit criminal activity. Let's go ahead and do that. I don't want to bust down random people's doors. It was bad enough we gave random people strip searches. You ride your Lawmaster to a Justice Department observation area and contact PSU, asking them to check the crowds below for known perps and to follow their activities while in the plaza. You quickly begin to get a few hits from known dunks and other petty thieves. A couple of things, however, stick out and attract your attention. The first is a known perp, one Jasmine Soames. Soames is a hardened criminal, recently released from an 8-year term for armed robbery with violence. But that was not her first such conviction. At almost 50 years old, she has had a long criminal history. She appears to be out on her weekly shop. Your attention is also attracted to members of the local street gang, the Tom Clancy Ryans. Ryans, nice. Who are moving through the crowd. You spot them on your monitors rather than having PSU direct your attention to them. You ask PSU why they have not been marked out for your notice. PSU responds that none of the group has had any serious convictions, that there are only a couple of minor offenses between them. Given the makeup of the group, this seems unlikely. The Ryans are an especially vicious gang of violent misfits. To have so many of them gathered together in one place and have none of them be hardcore lawbreakers is more than odd. Maybe there was a recruiting drive. You continue to follow the progress of Jasmine Soames across the plaza, or if the Ryans you wish to keep a close eye on instead. Well, Jasmine Soames has the one with the violent criminal history. Let's go ahead and follow her. Soames appears to be doing her grocery shopping, paying for small items at the various food stalls scattered around the edge of the plaza. Certain that she is not up to anything illegal at this moment in time, you turn your attention to the Ryans instead. Okay, well that was good to know just in case. It quickly becomes apparent that the Ryans are waiting for someone or something. Sure enough, a car pulls to the side of the plaza and a window opens. The juvies move over to the side of the car, and it looks as though they are deliberately making sure whatever is happening cannot be seen by observers. After a short stop, the car moves off and the juvies scatter, slowly mingling into the crowd. You can wait until the juvies have moved off and then grab one for interrogation to find out what is going on. You can see what, if anything, has changed about the gang members using the resources available to PSU. Or you can run a quick check on the car, seeing if it's linked to any criminal activity. If it's a quick check, let's try that. You run a quick check on the vehicle. It's registered to a suspected member of the Ripper Cartel. The Ripper Cartel is a major underworld group that deals drugs in the city, most notably Ziz. Now there is no doubt in your mind that the Ryans are involved in serious criminal acts, and you move to stop whatever is going on. Did you attend the briefing room back in Sector House earlier today? Yes, I did. Knowledge is power. You learned a lot about the Ripper Cartel earlier, which puts you at a distinct advantage. Your lawgiver skill increases by one for this encounter. So we can use the PSU's resources or grab one of the gang for interrogation. Let's go ahead and grab the gang for interrogation. I figure that's more Dredd style. You watch and wait for your moment before stepping out in front of a juvie out of about 13. The look on his face as you do is enough to confirm your suspicions. You know this will be too easy. Hardened perps have often crumbled when faced with interrogation by Mega City 1's finest. A juvie still wet behind the ears is unlikely to provide much resistance. You have some explaining to do, juvie, unless you want to spend the rest of your life in an ISO cube, you inform the young perp. The threat terrifies him and shrivels any thoughts of attempted bravado. They made me do it! I wasn't going to do anything wrong! It was the others! The juvie's desperate claim of innocence evaporates under your close examination and judicious use of the Birdie lie detector. It seems the juvies were being paid by a resident of Tom Clancy to pick up a package and deliver it to him. You secure your informant to a nearby holding post. This juvie did not know where the package was headed, but PSU have had his gang under surveillance. The one with the package is identified and his movements tracked. Once he enters an apartment, you begin to move in. You get to the apartment and notice the door is of non-standard construction, a heavily reinforced metal entranceway. It isn't illegal, but still very suspicious. You can attempt to trick your way in by knocking. Keep the door under surveillance and wait for an opportunity to pounce. Go up to the next level of the block and abseil down through the window. Or use a high explosive round against the wall of the apartment, making this a full-on assault. Well, we know that it has to deal with the Rippers, so that's going to be bad news right there. So I think a full-on assault would probably be best. And I like any excuse I can to use explosive rounds. So let's try that. You take aim at the wall besides the door and fire. The explosion that follows opens a gash in the wall which you are easily able to move through. Besides the door is an unconscious figure, probably the door's guard. Inside the apartment you can see the living area with a number of citizens in various stages of narcotic stupor. Most ignore you or look blankly at you. However, several are obviously not totally under the influence and begin to pull out guns. Oh, a firefight quickly erupts. There was a firefight! Boondock Saint reference there. Hyrule!
Bad move, creeps.
Indeed. The Ziz dealers are outmatched, and you soon clear the apartment of all resistance. The rest of the occupants surrender meekly, and you recover a large volume of drugs. Here's another one of these things. During your search, you also find another of the Voice of Dread gadgets. When you press the red button, you're rewarded with, "You bit off more than you could chew." I try to do like a little high-pitched voice, like, "You bit off more than you could chew." You press the button a few more times, and the phrases it comes out with are ones you have heard earlier, although there is a stomp. You also note the number of the LED as 186, and as you watch it changes to 185. You check with Control, informing them the Voice of Dreads might be on some sort of countdown. An auxiliary gets back to you and confirms all the Voice of Dreads in the evidence rooms are on the same number currently, 183. You share this information with Control, as it is now a matter of some urgency to find out what this countdown represents, and a general alert is given to all judges in this and neighboring sectors. With this matter now resolved, you deal with your prisoners. So, bad mojo going on with these things. Backup arrives, taking the prisoners into custody and securing the scene, leaving you free to move on and continue your patrol. The momentary lull in crime appears to be over, and life on the streets is returning to normal. Crime updates and reports, however minor, are streaming in once again from Control. One item attracts your attention. Students from the University of 106 appear to be up to mischief around their campus. To deal with them, turn to 280. You approach the university and see a large crowd gathered in Jerry Springer Plaza. Wow, really? It appears to be good-natured as you can make out laughter and clapping. However, with citizens, especially students, you can never tell. You walk across the plaza slowly to allow the crowds ahead to clear a path for you. Many of the citizens are laughing and smiling, with a few commenting on what a marvelous idea it is to collect money for charity in this way. As you get closer to the plaza, you see a young man carefully remove a purse from the shoulder bag of a lady in front of him. Nearby citizens just smile and point at his actions and snigger. Can you move in to arrest the punk? Second option is to question the nearby citizens and ascertain what exactly is going on. Or stand back and observe the crowd to see what other offenses are being committed. Well, it looks like we heard that, so apparently this is for charity. And removing a purse and shoulder bag. Let's stand back and observe the crowd first. See what's going on here. You watch the crowd and notice there are numerous dunks operating in the crowd. You can see numerous small signs and posters declaring the area to be a charity dunk zone, with details on how to get back any lost property clearly explained on the posters. You can see there are several tables set up with students and collection buckets where people appear to be collecting their purses and wallets, some of whom are giving small amounts of cash to each student. However, as you watch, a fight breaks out at one of the tables. Someone is not very happy. You rush over and find a citizen claiming his wallet has been stolen and the students will not give it back. The students, for their part, deny taking the wallet in question. Well, let's see. You can arrest those involved in this argument. Identify and arrest all those in the crowd that you have spotted taking valuables, plus those in the fight and the students at the desks. Or you can just arrest the whole crowd. Wow. Well, you know what? I think we should go ahead and arrest all in the crowd that you've spotted taking valuables, plus those in the fight and the students at the desk, because this was a bad idea to start with. So let's do this and just try and everyone take a breath. You pull out your day stick and start grabbing and arresting those members of the crowd involved in the criminal activity. Eventually, you make your way over to the fight, where a few citizens attempt to resist arrest. Ooh. Let's get to clubbing. Citizen 1 and Citizen 2. Alright, that's 7. He only has one defense dice, though. So he's clubbed. And I'm pretty sure I defended against that, and how. Alright.
You chose a one-way ticket to Recyke.
Indeed. So we've got the citizens under control. You crush the resistance with ease. The small rabble of aggressive citizens are no match for your street-honed skills and experience. Your actions seem to have quelled some of the more aggressive crowd members. However, you do still feel a level of discontent and you stand tall, casting an imposing shadow with Day Stick in hand. Make an authority check. What's my authority? I haven't actually used that. Authority of 8. So, if I roll under, so we gotta roll 8 or lower. Please, no high roll. It's not what I need today. Well, there's an 8. Oh, dang it. That's unfortunate. Fail the check. Another couple of men step out from the crowd with makeshift wooden weapons, which look like the stakes that are used to hold up banners. You sigh and move in with your day stick. Time to crush this public disobedience once and for all. I hope I did the right call here. And these guys have 2 offense. Oh, that was horrible, Dread. Took no damage. Now, 7. That's easy. Citizen 4 with an 8. Uh-oh, I actually got clobbered. Took 8 damage. Let's make him pay for that. Alright, for 5... Got that one. Now I hit 8 there. That should knock him out. There we go.
Justice has been served.
Now what's my vitality right now since I got... Oh, I have 28 out of 38. That's not too bad. After securing these prisoners, you set about arresting everyone else in the crowd involved in this event and any thieves who have taken advantage of it. As you search your prisoners, you find more of the Voice of Dread devices. This time you resist the temptation to push any of the red buttons, although you note the LED number is now 143. By the time you finish processing these petty criminals, the number is 111, as it takes a good half an hour to finally finish with the last of your arrest, allowing you to resume your patrol. You have a report of a drunk on nearby Kerry Walk, currently the closest location where a crime has been reported. Also, Control reports a group of young juvies acting suspiciously near some derelict buildings on Cooper Street. To see what they're up to, turn to 95. Well, I'll tell you what, guys. I'm probably going to end the episode here. I think this is a good place to end. We took care of quite a few things and found 2 of the Voice of Dread devices, so that's good. Real quick, I've been asked by several people to give my opinion on this regarding Judge Dredd. Whether I liked the original movie with Sylvester Stallone or I liked the Dread 3D with Carl Urban. To tell you guys the God's honest truth, I like both of them. The 2000 AD comic book series, if you ever looked at it, at times is very similar to both. It's kind of like if you took some of the campiness and comedy from the Judge Dredd movie with the violence of the Dread 3D, you kind of get a close of what the actual Judge Dredd comic book series was. And I like both of them. Both of them have their upsides and their downsides. I mean, but you have a Dread for whatever movie mood you're in. I mean, if you're in the mood for campy, you can watch Judge Dredd. If you're in the mood for, you know, serious violence and action, you can watch Dread 3D. Besides, I mean, the campiness, that's just kind of what it is. I mean, Judge Dredd and Demolition Man are the Big Trouble Little China of the 90s. But if someone put a gun to my head and said, "Wretch, you're going to make a choice here. Choose which of the 2 Dread movies you actually like," I would say Dread 3D without even blinking. You know why? Because that movie has 100% less Rob Schneider. That is the deciding factor for me. but I will go ahead and end it here. I don't know how much more of this game book actually there is, but I guess we'll find out in the new episode if it ends or if it keeps on going. But I hope you guys have enjoyed it. If you liked the video, go ahead and click like down below. Subscribe to the channel and leave a comment. That'd be a big help. And we'll see you next time. Later days, everyone.